see the hand of God. In the light of creation's grand design, in the lives of those who prove his faithfulness, ruled by faith and not by sight. By faith our fathers grow. The holy city built by God's own hand, a place where peace and justice reign. We will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on Him, our soul's reward, till the race is finished and the work is done. We'll walk by faith and triumphant from the grave. By faith the church was called to go in the power of the Spirit to the last, to deliver captives and to preach good news in every corner of the earth. We will stand mountain shall be moved, and the power of the gospel shall prevail. For we know in Christ all things are possible for all who call upon His name. We will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on Him, our soul's reward, and the work is done. We'll walk by faith and not by sight. We will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on Him, our soul's reward, till the race is finished and the work is done. We'll walk by faith and not by sight. We see the hand of God in the light of creation's grand design, in the lives of those who prove His faithfulness, ruled by faith and not by sight. By faith our fathers roamed the earth with the power in their hearts, of a holy city built by God's own hand, a place where peace and justice reign. We will stand as children of the promise. We will fix our eyes on Him, our soul's reward. Faith.
Ezekiel 37:1-14. The hand of the Lord was on me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord, and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth amongst them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, Son of man, can these bones live? I said, Sovereign Lord, you alone know. Then he said to me, Prophesy to these bones and say to them, Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Sovereign Lord says to these bones, I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you, and make flesh come onto you, and cover you with skin. I will put breath into you, and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to it, This is what the Sovereign Lord says, Come breath from the four winds and breathe into these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them, and they came to life and stood on their feet, a vast army. Then he said to me, Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say, Our bones are dried up and our hope is gone, we are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, This is what the Sovereign Lord says to my people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am Lord, when I open your graves and bring you up from them. I will put my spirit in you, and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord.
I am a child of God. Let's pray. Our Lord and Heavenly Father, we thank you for your presence with us. And we know the last month or so for us has been really, really tough work. We ask, Lord, that you will continue to be with the people who are in the places that are really savaged and ravaged by flood. We ask, Lord, that they will get the help that they need to be able to get back on with life. But we also ask that you will give them a real refreshment and recuperation. We also ask for those people who are in the Ukraine at the moment. We ask, Lord, for their protection. We ask, Lord, that you will keep them away from harm. But we also ask, Lord, that your spirit will move and will cease the war that is happening there. Lord, we ask this and we turn that over to you because we can't do it. As well as that, Lord, we ask that you will rejuvenate us, that you will give us the opportunity to be your people here in our community, right here and now. Lord, we just thank you and praise you for being a God that recycles and recovers people. And we ask, Lord, that for that now in your name. Amen.
the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains. Every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. The God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before Him. The God is the Lamb that was slain for the sins of the world. His blood breaks the chains.
Ezekiel is full of images. Some call them prophecies. Others call them sermons. Some of them probably both. And it's hard to understand, no doubt about it. This part of Ezekiel is in a strange style of writing. It's called apocalyptic. Apocalyptic literature is not familiar with most people. This is a type of literature which is in symbolic, visionary and prophetic understanding. And it's recorded like that too in the book of Revelation as well. And here, what we have is the interpreter of the scene is the Spirit of the Lord. And yeah, I say, it's a little bit tricky to understand, but it's really worth us having a look at. And it has things to say to us, and I think it has things to say to us right now. The scenario is spelled out in verse 1, and it says, "The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley." It was full of bones. It is God who puts Ezekiel in this position in the valley. Is it a real valley or is it purely vision? I don't know the answer to that. And maybe it doesn't matter. I think for me, it is important to think that God could have done it this way physically if he chose to. The word says, set me in the middle of a valley. It doesn't say I saw a valley, which would, to me, sort of give the idea that it's not just a vision. It's a physical thing for Ezekiel. So maybe God took him somewhere to show him all of this. It is what he sees that is the important thing. It says in verse 2, he led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley. Bones were very dry. Whether or not he sees the leftovers of a great battle, or maybe a dumping ground of bodies outside a city, I don't know that. A scene of absolute death and devastation is what he sees. Also, a sight of absolute hopelessness. And that's what God asks. The bones are very dry, indicates they've been dead for a while. And God asks, "Son of man, can these bones live?" Now, you can imagine Ezekiel's thought patterns here. Yeah, right, these guys are gone, they're dead, and dead is dead. No chance of that. But there's an element of respect here, isn't there? He's seen God do amazing things. So he says, "I said, O sovereign Lord, you alone know." I love the imagery here of this passage. God just doesn't do things himself. It's like in the book of Acts, God uses and includes us in his plans. That is pretty amazing, as he can do it all by himself. But he chooses here to use Ezekiel, and he chooses in our life to choose to use us. He says in verse 4, "And he said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord." This is the whole foot bones connected to the ankle bone and the ankle bones connected to the shin bone, and it goes on and on. More importantly, God says what he'll do. Why? So we know he's God. "Then you will know that I am the Lord."
That's a huge statement. Verse 5 goes on and says, this is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I'll put breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord. Whoa! Now, I'm wondering what's going through Ezekiel's mind. Like, yeah, whatever you reckon. But sometimes God works to show us that he is God, to prove that he is real, to confirm that he is who he says he is. So what does Ezekiel do? He does as he's told. So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked and the tendons and the flesh appeared on them and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Here God is making it happening, miracles before Ezekiel's eyes. This is beyond imagination stuff. Absolutely impossible, but God does it. But it's an incomplete miracle. The miracle was physical and amazing and fantastic, but not quite real because they were still dead bodies. Notice here is a progression, a working over time. How long between the two statements? We don't know exactly, but there's a progression. Ezekiel prophesied twice. God worked twice. Both fit together for it to be total and complete. We get that in verse 9 where it says, then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe into these slain that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them. They came to life and stood on their feet, a vast army. Now the word for breath here can be also the same word for wind or spirit. So God breathed the necessary life into them. He has these bones, things that were necessary, put them all together, and then they're alive. It's amazing. He gave life to those hopeless situation. He gave life to a dead thing, life to those who didn't deserve a second go. Wow, this is big stuff. God can make alive what has been dead, like Jesus' resurrection, like in our own situation with us being apart from God. What's God's point in all this? Then he said to me, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say our bones are dried up and our hope is gone and we are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says. O my people, I'm going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and bring you up from them, I will put my spirit in you and you will live. I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken and I've done it, declares the Lord. That's a bit huge, isn't it? Well, one reason that all of this happens is for us to know God. And one reason comes from that whole Christmas story. If we didn't have Christmas, we'd be like dry bones. Jesus coming, his life, his death, his resurrection, the Easter story, and it all comes together and gives us a chance to be like the vast army. We have breath, the spirit. We live again, we live. The thing is, we have this opportunity. Jesus' death and resurrection is not possible without Christmas. It's not possible without the first part, but we've got to have that. And then the death and resurrection means that our dry bones can live. Why has God given us this to read just at the moment? Because he wants us to recognize things. Firstly, often the situation seems hopeless, like the dry bones, but God can and still work. We are to participate in God's work, just like Ezekiel did. He uses us to work things through, to prophesy, if you like. The third point is we do the prophesying, we do the proclaiming, that is the preaching. That's our job. And God's Spirit is what is needed. Let Him do the work. God can do great things with dry bones. Imagine what He wants to do with our dry bones. Bless you. In closing, the benediction. Lord, we thank You that You are recycling us. We thank You, Lord, that You are rejuvenating us. And we thank You, Lord, that You can still use us even when we feel like dry bones. Lord, take what we have to offer and use it this week. And now may the grace, mercy, and peace of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit remain with each of these people until You come. Amen.